Of course, we all know we can never violate the laws of nature, or at least that's what we've been told. But what if I told you that we can sometimes manipulate them to our advantage? I'm Nergis Mavalvala, and as part of my work with the MIT LIGO team, I'm looking for ways to ever so slightly bend the laws of nature to help us explore the dark and warped side of the universe. Humans have been looking out at the stars for millennia, but it wasn't until Galileo built a telescope in 1601 that we could see much further out into space than our naked eyes would allow. And that was a paradigm shift. With increasingly more powerful telescopes, we have revealed a universe with light that is vast and amazing. But how might we see objects that don't emit light? If we want to see objects like black holes, we must use some other property of theirs that isn't light. That property turns out to be their gravity. And gravity has a messenger, gravitational waves, ripples in the very fabric of space-time itself. LIGO detects these gravitational waves with laser interferometers that have sufficient precision to measure the motion of mirrors that are 4 kilometers apart, moving by about 1,000th the size of a single proton as the gravitational wave passes through them. In 2015, we saw the first direct signatures of gravitational waves from 2 colliding black holes, and that was thrilling. Then, in 2017, we saw something equally profound, the collisions of 2 neutron stars. Neutron stars are the cousins of black holes. When black holes collide, the only thing that's given off is gravitational waves, usually. And that's because black holes are black. Even light can't escape their gravitational pull. But neutron stars are a whole nother thing. They're made of neutrons. When neutron stars collide, their gravitational wave emission is accompanied by a spectacular light show. So, on this particular day in August 2017, LIGO saw gravitational waves from a neutron star collision. We were able to identify that the collision occurred at a location in the sky that could be observed from the southern hemisphere by telescopes. It was daytime there at the time we made the detection, so scientists had about 11 hours to prepare to look for this new object in the sky. And that night, over 70 telescopes pointed at that part of the sky where LIGO had seen the gravitational wave emission, and they found an entirely new object. When neutron stars orbit each other, they're dark. But when they collide, boom, there is an enormous flash of light. And that flash of light can last days, weeks, months. When scientists measured the light, we saw something amazing. From the different colors of light emitted, we saw elements of the periodic table being fused in real time. And this helped us solve a long-standing puzzle of where heavy elements like gold and platinum come from. We discovered that neutron stars are the factories where these heavy elements are manufactured. And that's not all. Until now, we have thought that we, this planet, we humans, that we're made of stardust. But now we know that we are really made of neutron star dust as well. But just seeing ones and twos isn't enough. A black hole here, a neutron star there. That's a little bit like aliens coming here to the Earth and meeting one human and concluding that all humans are like this one human. So we have to measure many such systems to understand their properties. And I look for ways to make the LIGO detectors we use to detect gravitational waves even more sensitive. But when we try to do that, we come face to face with one of nature's most fundamental properties, quantumness. Quantum uncertainty demands that no matter how clever you are with your apparatus, how good of an experimentalist you are, your measurement must be uncertain. And that's what happens with LIGO. Quantum uncertainty meddles with the measurement we're trying to make. How? Well, LIGO measures the positions of mirrors using laser light. You shine a laser beam at a mirror, the mirror reflects the light back, you measure how long it took the light to travel, and you can measure the distance. Essentially, the wavelength of the light is like the tick marks on our ruler. My group works on ways to get around these limits on our quantum ruler, limits imposed by nature. Basically, we ask, how can we make LIGO more precise by tricking quantum mechanics, even though we can never actually violate the laws of quantum mechanics? The answer lies in a specially engineered quantum state of light called a squeezed state. Squeezed light is engineered in such a way that the spacing between the tick marks on our light ruler can be made more precise. Remember, quantum mechanics always makes you pay the price. And the price that you pay then is that the height of the tick marks on your ruler become more imprecise. They jitter up and down a lot more, but the spacing between them becomes more steady. Now, you can't do this ad nauseum because eventually the height of your tick marks will become so imprecise that it will sometimes go to zero, and now you have little to measure with. But this is what quantum mechanics does. It allows you to use special tricks where you can reapportion uncertainty from, in our case, the spacing between the tick marks of our ruler to the height of the tick marks and vice versa. And that lets you make a more precise measurement. We make these squeeze states of light in our lab, then we inject them into LIGO, and voila, we have a more precise measurement of gravitational waves. And in fact, this has worked out really well for us. Since we got our squeezer working, LIGO went from measuring about one astrophysical event per month to over one per week. Now we're not just measuring a handful of events here and there, we're already seeing things that we've never seen before, and they're quite unexpected. This is what comes from discovery. You just keep asking the next question. You don't discover something and then pack up and go home. You've just figured out the next question that needs to be asked, and you keep going. We have close to 100 detections so far, and we're gonna keep going. Now, having had this joy of discovery in my own work makes me want to bring this experience to scientists everywhere. And bringing that joy to my colleagues and students in the MIT community, that's something I love in my new capacity as dean, to enable the science of others, to make discoveries possible for all my colleagues, for our students, and for the MIT community. I hope you also share my excitement about the future of science. Look, this is a time when science is under attack, and we all need to share our excitement about science with anyone who will listen. To me, the world is enormous. It's a vast world out there, and for us to make a better world, we must first understand that world. And at MIT, that's just what we do. Thank you.